My name is John Higgins, and welcome to another Sal St. George show. If you've been here before, it's always a pleasure to see you. Welcome back. And if you're new to our programs, welcome to the party. This is how we start our week. Every Monday morning, we celebrate entertainment's leaders, legends, and icons. And this morning is certainly no exception. Today, Sal is visiting the Canadian Women in Film Museum, where we are going to be celebrating Mary Pickford, Marie Dressler, and we're going to see a little bit of Norma Shearer's stuff, as well as some other very important and, I would say, historically significant women in Canadian cinema. We are honored to be joined by Rick and Jill from the Canadian Women in Film Museum. Please be sure to keep your camera and microphone off throughout today's program. If you have any questions on Zoom or on Facebook, please feel free to share them in the chat. I will relay any questions you have over to Sal and Rick. And please hop on the chat right now and let us know where you're joining us from. Next week, Sal will take another virtual road trip to the Buffalo Bill Center of the West. But for today, without any further ado, let's get right to it. Here's the man of the hour, Sal St. George. Sal, good morning. Are you there?
And good morning, John. Good morning, everybody. And I'm thrilled. We're heading to Canada. You can put away your passport. You don't need it today. We're going right through to the museum. And let's get Rick and Jill in here right away so that we can start this process. I'm excited about this.
Me too.
Yeah. Okay. They're coming on. There we go. Hi, Rick.
Hello.
Good morning to you.
Good morning. Welcome.
So, Rick, how long have you been with the museum?
Well, I've been with the Marie Dressler Foundation, which owns and operates the museum, for 13 years. And the museum has been open starting in 2015, and then our latest addition to it was done last year.
So, just so we can avoid the confusion, it was the Marie Dressler Museum. Now it's the Marie Dressler Foundation. And you're now the Canadian Women in Film Museum?
Yes. Let me tell you a little bit about the house that we're standing in and where the museum is located. This house was built in 1840. And it's where Marie Dressler was actually born in 1868. And for about the 100 years of its existence, it was used as a rental property for families. Marie's family lived here for a few years. She was born here in Coburg. When they moved away, another family moved in and so forth. By the 1930s, when Marie became popular, people would take the ferry from Rochester to Coburg, knock on the door and say, I want to see where Marie lived. And of course, there was a family living here, and that wasn't really too popular with them. But the people who actually owned the house thought, hey, there's a little something here. They convinced their daughter to come and help them open a restaurant. In 1937, they opened Marie Dressler's Dining Place, it was called. And if you look at the restaurant logs from 1937, you'll see 9 out of every 10 visitors was from the U.S. It ran as a restaurant until 1989. And then there was a giant fire that resulted in this building being demolished. It was saved by the community. And as part of that, we end up building a museum to Marie's homage, and then later on expanding it to cover other remarkable Canadian women.
So you said the restaurant opened in 1937?
Yes, operated from 1937 to 1979.
So Marie never really... Yeah, she passed away in 1934, so she never saw this.
She did not, no.
But she did know that people were coming to the house?
I think so. I mean, her 65th birthday party was November 9th, 1933. Broadcast across the U.S., but also broadcast here into Coburg. So she knew that people in Coburg were so interested in her and were celebrating her achievements.
Okay. All right. Let's start the tour. Let's get moving on this and see what you have for us.
Okay. So first I want to just ask the audience, do you know that in the 1920s and 1930s, women ruled Hollywood? Between 22 and 25, half of the films were written by women. The important social issues of the day were raised by women screenwriters. The largest salaries were earned by women. In fact, Mary Pickford was the first actor, male or female, to earn $1 million a year salary. The top movie-making stars were women in 1932, between 1932 and 1938. In fact, in 1932 and 1933, during the Great Depression, Marie Dressler was the top box office draw in the world. So think about who else was on the scene at those at that time: Greta Garbo, Clark Gable, Jean Harlow, etc. By 1935, about 70% of the audience in the movie theater were women. And in the first 4 years of the Oscars, three Canadian-born women won the Best Actress Oscar: Marie Dressler, who was born in this house, Mary Pickford, and Norma Shearer. And their groundbreaking influence came to an end in the 1940s, and women are still working to get their voice at the table and their well-deserved recognition.
Now, these three women that you're talking about, did they all know one another, being they were all from Canada?
They did. They did. Norma and Marie were at the same studio, MGM. Mary Pickford, and the common bond between Mary Pickford and Marie Dressler was Frances Marion, the famous screenwriter, who wrote a lot of Mary's scripts, but also wrote scripts that featured Marie at MGM.
And Mary Pickford was involved with Chaplin and D.W. Griffith, and they started their own studio.
Well, they started a distribution company called United Artists, and we're going to show you some of that when we take our little walk around.
Okay, let's get going. Let's get into the museum.
Okay, great. So our big idea here was that these three actresses, Marie Dressler, Mary Pickford, and Norma Shearer, they leveraged and subverted, really, the gendered expectations of their time to make advancements in the film industry in the early 20th century. So if you think about the society they operated in, they were able to make great strides, have great influence in the industry, and really to inspire contemporary efforts to achieve gender equality in front of and behind the camera. So we're going to start by showing you some of Marie Dressler, then we're going to go over to Mary Pickford, visit Norma Shearer, and then we'll finish by talking about some other remarkable Canadian women. So okay. come into the gallery here, and we're going to start, and all the galleries are organized the same way. We have major themes on the wall, supported by pictures, and then we have iPads that give you a more of an interactive experience. So
can we get a close-up of those pictures that you have there?
Yeah, so we're going to show you a picture of Marie when she was a little girl living here in this house. And she's about 7 years old in this picture. They only lived here for a few years, and they would move around quite a bit. Her father was a piano teacher, and down below is a picture of father and mother. Father was a piano teacher, and he would sign up a bunch of students, but he had a short temper. So eventually he would lose the students, and the family income would suffer, so they would pick up and move to another town. Marie never really had a lot of respect for her father. She loved her mother dearly, but she found her father was a bit too stern, and she ran away from home at age 14.
And so, she had a sister, right?
She had a sister, an older sister called Bonita. Now, her name was Lila Kerber when she was born, and she changed it to a stage name of Marie Dressler when she went on stage in the late 70s. So let's talk about her stage career a bit here. As I say, she ran away from home at age 14 to join sort of the traveling theater shows that would perform in a town for a week or sometimes less, then move on. By the turn of the century, she was very popular, and there's a picture of her up above there. Is a picture of her in 1896 in a play that made her famous called The Lady Slavey. By the turn of the century, so we're now talking the early 19s and 1910s, Marie Dressler was the top box office draw on Broadway. And here she is in Tilly's Nightmare. That played on Broadway for a couple of years. And Marie became very well known because of that. As a result, in 1913, she, Charlie Chaplin, and Mabel Normand appeared in a film called Tilly's Punctured Romance, which is the first full-length silent comedy, and it was based on this movie.
Was that a Max Sennett film?
Yes. So that's we show that from time to time. And it's quite entertaining because Charlie Chaplin looks like a little rag doll compared to Marie dancing with him. So Marie only made a few silent movies, and then the war came along. And so, Marie took time out from the movie business and the theater business to raise money for the war effort. And after the war was ended, she went back to the theater. Now, in 1919, there was a big actor strike. Marie stood up for the chorus girls because that's where she started herself. But when the strike was ended, all the theater owners in New York City blacklisted her. So she went from highest paid performer to unemployed and unemployable. So she basically went and did, community theater and helped with those charity gigs from time to time until 1927. She was really kind of at the end of her rope. She had exhausted her bank account, and she didn't know what she was going to do. And she was considering maybe she had to go and work as a domestic. Her friend, Frances Marion, heard about her plight. And here's a picture of Frances and Marie. And at this time, Frances was the head screenwriter at MGM. Years earlier, Marie had done Frances a favor by granting her an exclusive interview, and that helped Frances's career. And now it was Frances's turn to help Marie. So she got her into this movie called The Callahans and the Murphys. And here's a cast picture. You'll see Marie on the left for one family and Pauli Moran for the other family. And that got Marie back in front of the camera. The unfortunate thing was, the Irish really didn't like the stereotype, the movie. And together with the Catholic Church, they forced MGM to not only pull it out of the theaters, but to destroy any prints that existed of that film.
So, Rick, I have a question for you. We went by it so quickly. When she had trouble on Broadway, was that the actor strike when they were trying to unionize?
Yes, 1919.
Okay, so that George M. Cohan was against the unionization of the actors at that point, caused a lot of problems for him as well.
Yes, and from what I read, nobody wanted to negotiate with Marie because she was a tough cookie. So she was able to help settle the strike, and that's why she became unpopular with the theater owners, because they saw her as perhaps a troublemaker in the future. So after this film was pulled from the theater, and what we have is a rare cast picture here. So this is great. Anybody that's still alive today probably has not seen this movie because it was only in the theaters for a short time and then it was pulled. So Marie got back in front of the camera, but by no means was she a movie star at this point in time.
Rick, is that movie still available?
This movie has been destroyed. There's no copies of it that exists.
Do we know who any of the children in that cast were?
I don't have the names. I mean, we can find out because, the cast has been published, but we've got the names displayed here. Sorry.
Gotcha.
Okay. So let's come down here to Marie continuing her movie. And between 1927 and 1933, Marie made 22 films. But her real breakthrough role was in 1930-31, a movie called Anna Christie. And this starred Marie and Greta Garbo. Now, Greta Garbo was a famous silent star, but nobody had ever heard her speak. And we're now in the era of talking movies. She had a very thick accent, Swedish accent. So the again, Frances Marion convinced the studio to put Marie in the film with Greta Garbo to kind of offset the two characters, make them totally different. And Marie played the role of a sort of a drunken wharf rat. She stole the show. If you watch the movie, it's very clear that Marie's performance was outstanding. And that got her back on top in terms of the film world.
I think that was the when they were putting out the posters, the big tagline on that was Garbo Speaks.
Sorry, we kind of lost you there. Can you repeat the question?
I was saying that when she made that film, Garbo, she was coming out of silent films. The tagline on the posters was Garbo Speaks.
Garbo Speaks, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So Marie went on to make a number of other films. In 1930, she starred in the drama called Min and Bill with Wallace Beery. And that was the film that she won her Academy Award for Best Actress. And we have at the museum here the ability to show a trailer of that film. And we do that. Marie went on to make a number of other films. She made a film called Dinner at Eight with a big cast lineup here. She made a movie called Emma the year after she won her Academy Award. She was nominated for Best Actress again in Emma, but she didn't win. And of course, Tugboat Annie was with Wallace Beery as well.
Well, Dinner at Eight gives that perfect tagline to the film with she and Jean Harlow.
Yes. Yeah, that last scene is perfection.
Now, I noticed we walked by very quickly. There was a old-fashioned phonograph there.
Sorry, say that again?
We walked by. There was an old-fashioned phonograph on display in your...
Yes. Yeah, let's go back to that. And the story there is this is circa 1910 gramophone. And the wax cylinders... were used in those days to record voices. So this display has some wax cylinders. The one that's actually here is the one that with Marie singing. We've been able to extract the voice of Marie from the wax cylinder, and we can actually play it on the iPad right next to the display here. These things are very fragile, so the rest of the originals are stored in our archives. But it's quite amazing to hear a recording from 1910 with the little crackles and pops that come from the wax cylinder.
Can you play that for us, Rick?
I can play it, and we'll hold the headphones up to the camera, and then we'll be able to give you a sense of what that sounds like. Now, I want to caution you and your audience that the lyrics in these older songs were somewhat questionable by today's standards, but I will play it for you. Okay, here we go. This is 1910, I'm Gonna Change My Man, sung by Marie Dressler.
Thank you for sharing that, Rick.
Okay. So when we were putting this exhibit together, we thought a movie star deserves a dressing table. Of course, we couldn't find anything that was period accurate. And of course, because of the accessibility standards, we had to make sure people could get by. So we designed this little Art Deco dressing table. And we thought, okay, there's the mirror that people can look into. And let's have some fun. So instead of just a mirror, we have the ability for people to walk up to the iPad and just play a bunch of pictures and have some fun watching Marie do her thing.
It's very clever.
I quite like that, yes.
And here she is at dinner at 8. Carlotta Vance, the fading former star. And here's a clip, a little gif from Anna Christie. So while we're here, we want to point to something we received from the city of Los Angeles. On Marie's 150th birthday in 2018, the city of Los Angeles sent us this beautiful scroll document signed by the mayor and all the council members of the city of Los Angeles, saying in part that they're celebrating Marie's contribution to the economy of Los Angeles as the top box office draw in 1932 and 33, and helping keep MGM in the black during the Great Depression. So that was very precious for us to receive that at that point in time. And just as a crowning thing to show you before we go to Mary Pickford, I want to show you a clip of Marie receiving her Oscar. So, Jill, you want to aim towards there?
And it's kind of interesting who is giving it to her.
Yes, I'm going to keep that as a little surprise until you see it on screen.
I want to thank the Academy for allowing me to present this award to the most distinguished actors of this past year. Our tribute goes to someone who is not only a great artist, but to someone whom we all dearly love. A grand old trooper with transmission fame in two generations. Miss Mary Dress.
And of course, that was Norma Shearer presenting the Oscar to Marie, because Norma was the winner of the previous year.
Okay, so, and the significance of the trunk that you're walking by.
Well, we wanted it to represent her days on stage and going from town to town. All her life belongings would have been packed into a trunk like this. So this is an actual vintage from the 1900s. Trump. And what we did is reproduce some of those stickers in places that she would have played. So we're showing it as Marie's Trump, but it's sort of a proxy for her real Trump.
Every Broadway star, every vaudevillian, they all had a trunk just like this.
Yes, absolutely. And we'll quickly go back by our display case. Marie was the first actor and the first Canadian to have a cover story on Time, and that was in 1933. That's only a few months before she passed away. She passed away in 1934. Of course, Canada does stamps for famous people, so there's her stamp. She has a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, and here's the original plaque from her star. And that was granted in 1960. And then, of course, we saw Norma present the Oscars. This is just a photo of the same thing. Okay, are we ready to move over to Mary Pickford?
Sounds good.
Are we ready to move over to Mary Pickford?
Oh, yes.
Okay. So Mary Pickford was born in Toronto, Canada. And our earliest picture of Mary, she's standing on the left with her younger brother and her older sister, her mother, and a couple relatives. This was taken in 1899 when Mary was 7 years old. Mary became a performer at a very early age. She was on stage by age 8. Here's a picture of her in 1900 when she was performing in a play called The Silver King, and in 1901 from Uncle Tom's Cabin. And what impresses us the most about these things, these pictures are over 100 years old, 120 years old, and they're just in pristine condition. So we're very pleased about that. As we look over here, this is her house that doesn't exist anymore. But again, with the iPads, we have the ability to show different things and people can get more information. So if we look at this iPad, for example, we have four choices. You can dive in a little bit more about her Canadian background, her time on the stage as a child, her mother, who was her mentor and manager, and her siblings that appeared in films with her. So you'll get a story here, and you'll scroll through. And basically what you can do is you can select a picture. And because it's an iPad, we can actually stretch it. So this picture is 100 years old. This is Mary and her mother. Okay, let's move on.
Rick, how do you acquire these pictures? Did somebody approach you? How did you get all these wonderful old pictures?
Well, you'll see down here, we put the credits for everything, right? So, for example, this one was from the Rob Brooks Mary Pickford collection at the Film Reference Library at the Toronto International Film Festival. There was a gentleman named Rob Brooks, who was a major collector of Mary Pickford things, donated his whole collection to TIFF, Toronto International Film Festival, a film reference library, and we were able to get the permission to use it from them. We also have a very strong relationship with Mary Pickford Foundation in Los Angeles, and they've given us the rights to show a video that was owned by Mary Pickford Company. And we'll show you a video clip when we get around to that. Does that help?
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, we have a lot of Marie Dressler stuff, but when we set out on this journey for Mary Pickford, we had no Mary Pickford stuff. So now we're really pleased by what we have. So as we continue to look at Mary's career, we have some of the earliest examples of her appearances in film. She started in 1909. So down here is a picture of one of her first roles. Here she is in 1918, where she plays two roles in the...
Well, I think he froze.
Yep, a little bit of an internet connection.
Yeah, he'll be back in 3 seconds. It'll take a second, folks. I'd like to find out how old she was when she started doing these productions, the films. Mm-hmm. Sit tight, everybody. They'll be right back.
We need a message from our sponsors.
Yeah. We're experiencing technical difficulties. What we have learned in the 3 years of doing these, many of these museums have difficulty with their Wi-Fi, and we've had that quite often.
Oh, looks Rick like they're back.
Hello, Rick.
Try to get them unmuted.
Yes. Okay. As I was saying, we've been to many of these museums, and there are several that...
Hi there.
Oh, are we okay, Jill?
Hello?
Yep. Can you hear us?
Are we back?
Yes, you are. We're here, Rick.
Uh-oh. Now maybe they can hear us. Hello.
Hi, can you hear us?
Yes, we can hear you. I think...
Can you hear us? Oh, we must have found the Wi-Fi dead zone.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi, sorry about that.
Okay, you can hear us?
Hmm.
Don't think so.
We can see you, John.
Hello, can you hear us?
Hi.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, we can hear you now. Okay, sorry about that.
It's okay. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for your patience. Okay.
Our iPad.
When you were showing those,
so I'm not sure why the Wi-Fi signal is so flaky. But anyway, okay.
When she was on those early films, how old was she?
Well, in 1909, she would have been only a teenager, so she'd be about 15 or 16 mm-hmm. at that time. And in the first the period 1909 to 1913, Mary made 100 films. Now think about that. And these were shorter films, but she made 100. In her career, Mary appeared in 246 movies as an actress. So very prolific career in terms of appearances.
What people don't realize, though, Rick, is these women, Marie and Mary, these were pioneers. There was no such thing as a motion picture before they came along. They were creating the screen presence that we now appreciate. And they were doing it just off the just from their own instincts on how they felt it should be.
Yeah, and think of it. Mary owned her own studio, Mary Pickford's Pictures. And, it was unheard of in those days for a woman to be that involved in the industry. And one of the pictures, we're going to walk back over to the wall and hopefully we don't lose the connection. But we'll just stay a little further away. And I'll just point to a couple of pictures. Here she is in 1922. Supervising the production of the film that she started in, and there's some pulleys and stuff going on. It's a picture of her and Frances Marion in 1921. Over on this wall, we have a picture of her checking out the camera angles in 1917 for a film called Pride of the Clan. And then down here, she starred in a film called Little Lord Fauntleroy, where she played two roles, the mother and the son. And there's a scene where the little boy comes and kisses his mother on the cheek. And of course, this is the days before, special effects were perfected. So it took them hours and hours to get that scene. And it was in the movie for maybe 6 seconds.
Now, was Mary also directing at this point?
She was picking her directors. She was picking her screenwriters. She had complete control over the creative process. So essentially, the director did what you want the director to do.
So people like Barbara Streisand got to tip her hat to Mary Pickford for opening those doors.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So you asked earlier about United Artists. So let's walk down there and just look at a couple of pictures on the back wall here. Mary was a founding member of the Academy. So there's a picture of her with a whole bunch of guys. She's the only woman in the picture, and she's the only one smiling. That was in 1927.
I think we might be having another connection hiccup, hopefully one of the shorter ones.
I think once they created this United Artists, I can talk a little bit about Chaplin because he was part of it. The first film he made out of there, I believe, was A Dog's Life. And then he did another, but the big thing for him is once they had control of creating their own content, he did a film called The Kid, which was the first full-length comedy. And he was mixing comedy with drama, and it was the first time being done that way. And that was a huge hit for him. Interesting. Oh, Rick's back.
Hi there. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
I think we're okay. Video's looking good. Yes.
Now. Yeah. Sorry about that. It seems okay. To be one particular couple as we get closer to the walls.
Why don't you stay where you are?
Yeah.
And we'll do the long shots, and I'll explain to people what they can see. So in this picture here, we have Mary Pickford, Charlie Chaplin, Douglas Fairbanks, and D.W. Griffiths signing the agreement to create United Artists. Wow. On the iPad here, we have the story. And we're very fortunate because Mary Pickford Foundation has the rights to the film of them giving a press conference. So if we look at this film, we'll see that they're all lined up and they're cranking the cameras.
Rick, do you have any of this on your website?
No, some of this is the copyright issues that we've got to be careful with when we post the stuff publicly.
We've experienced that problem too.
Yeah. So you can see the watermark here from Mary Pickford Foundation, for example. There's Charlie Chaplin with his mustache. They're getting ready to sign. And look at him when he's indoors. Mustache is gone. That's the same picture we have up here. Okay. So that was that.
And what is in the cabinet that Jill is next to? You're just walking by it.
Well, what we wanted to do was to have something that represented Mary's involvement with the movie industry as a creator. So we were looking for something, and we thought, well, wouldn't a Moviola be great? And then when we started looking around on eBay, the authentic ones would be $1 gazillion. But we talked to the Academy and they said, you know what? We've got an authentic one in our inventory and we'll be happy to put it on loan for display at your museum.
And for those that don't know what a Moviola is, would you explain it?
Sure. Moviola was an editing machine, and this is in the silent era. So we asked them to take the big arms off, otherwise the case would be too big. But this Moviola was then loaned to us by the Motion Picture Editors Guild. At the
I think we lost your sound.
To us.
There we go.
When they lent this to us, they said there's a backstory. So that movie, The Aviator, with Leo DiCaprio playing Howard Hughes, there's a scene of a woman with her back to us at one of these machines. Howard Hughes is saying, you know, cut this, leave that in, cut this. This is the machine that was actually in The Aviator, the actual machine, replicating Howard Hughes' days in the film business. And the woman who had her back to us and who was editing the film was a woman named Ann Coates, who was the film editor for Lawrence of Arabia.
Wow.
So, a little piece of history there. Mary became the most famous woman in the world. And we have a picture here of her and Douglas Fairbanks putting their handprints in Grauman's Chinese theater there. And I believe they were the first ones. And that's a picture of Sid Grauman with Mary and Douglas Fairbanks.
Do you know? Do you know if Mary and Chaplin got along? Oop, I think we got another hiccup.
I think they had their differences of opinion.
Mm-hmm. But he was very close with Douglas Fairbanks.
Well, they all had good relationships because they had to work together at United Artists. They were partners. But and I think Charlie Chaplin would be a frequent visitor to Pickfair, which was the name of their residence. But I'm not sure Mary had any particular extra affection for Charlie Chaplin other than a business relationship.
And do you know what happened to Pickfair?
Well, eventually it got sold, but we have a picture of Mary just before she died receiving her honorary Oscar, and they presented it to her at her home, and that was in 1976. So if you go on the Academy website, they have a clip of them rolling up to her house, walking through her house, and Mary's in this little person in this big chair, and they give her the Oscar. And here's a color picture of her with the Oscar. Okay, got that?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Well, I'm going to go back to the back wall here for a minute. Mary used her fame in many ways. Here she is raising money for the war effort. Here she is helping the local economy, Beverly Hills, with a fundraiser. She was involved in helping healthcare for women. So here she is in picture. This was taken in the 1930s. She was also made a propaganda film for the war. And she was instrumental in creating the motion picture Country Home for those actors and actresses that were disadvantaged and couldn't really take care of themselves. And she was a major donor, but also a major person to make sure it happened. And she was also a mentor to up-and-coming young actresses. This is taken in 1928. And there was a group called the WAMPUS, which is Western Association Motion Picture Advertisers. Every year, they found 13 young women to promote getting into films. And some of them would make it big, and some of them wouldn't do so well. This is the 1928 class, and I don't have all the names for you. Mary's there in the middle. She was a mentor. But some of them made it big. Joan Crawford came up this way. Fay Wray came up this way. And Ginger Rogers came up this way.
Do you have any idea about the relationship with her? Did she have any relationship with Shirley Temple, considering Shirley did remakes of many of the films that Mary Pickford made?
I don't know if she did or not, quite frankly. It's probably a research item for us to look into, but it hasn't come up in any of the research we've done so far. We want to show you, Mary was known for her little girl archetype, which was the long blonde curls, well into her early 30s. And she played teenager roles until she was into her 30s. So we're going to show you a clip right now. This is about a minute long. And you can see Mary in a silent movie. So we'll give you a couple to see. Breakthrough role in 1914 called Tess of the Storm Country. This is a minute 13 seconds. This is a movie that put Mary on the map. You're the one I want to see. When nights turn the temple, will you say a prayer for me? Say a prayer for me in the sun. Say a prayer for me in the sun. Say a prayer for me in the sun. So that was the film that put her on the map for the audiences. And one of her later, almost last films was in 1926. This is less than a minute, this clip, called Sparrows. And you can see she's still playing the role of a young woman, much below her age range. And she still has those long braided hair. So here she is in Sparrows. In this scene, these are real alligators. And there was only ropes down below in case anybody slipped. So that was their safety feature in those days.
And for anybody out there that has not seen a silent movie for fear that it's going to be dragged out, or uninvolving, you've got to see some of these. That clip you just showed, I've seen that movie several times. Check out any silent film, any of the classics. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised.
Well, it's interesting because Mary was never a fan of talking movies. And as a matter of fact, before they came out, she said, why would anybody ever want to hear sound in a movie? It's like putting lipstick on Venus de Milo. Mary only made 5 talking films, and her first talking film was Coquette in 1929, and she won her Academy Award for it. Now, there's some saying that it was both the film that got her the Oscar, but it was also her 20 plus years of making over 200 films that was recognized in giving her the Oscar.
Well, her reluctance to get into sound movies is she had that in common with Chaplin.
Yeah, and think of the difference between her and Marie. Marie had been on stage, so she had to broadcast her voice. There were no microphones. She had to memorize lines because in a play, she had to talk. Then she went to the silent movies. She was used to performing, so she had the body language and the gestures. And Marie did a lot of her own stunts. When it came to talking movies, a lot of the silent stars didn't make it to the talking movies. They didn't have the voice for it. They didn't have to memorize lines in the silent era. But Marie, she was a star from that point of view because all the way along, she had developed all those skills.
Interesting question. Who was Mary's biggest rival in film? Was it Lillian Gish?
Well, I'm not sure. I mean, you know, if you're talking different eras, there would be different people. Mm-hmm. Think of what I said earlier. Marie Dressler in 1932 and 33 was top of the box office for those 2 years. And yet Mary was still making films, a couple of sound films, right? So in that regard, you know, Marie outdrew her. And I'm sure on a film-by-film basis, there were other competitors. But no one stands out that, you know, people talk about saying, well, you know, Mary was really trying to get the better of so-and-so.
Thank you.
Although from what we're learning, Mary was an innovator. She was a pioneer. She was one of the first business women in Hollywood. So the Gish sisters worked with D.W. Griffith, and I don't recall them having their own studio or anything like Mary Pickford did.
No, and making the quantity of movies in front of the camera.
Yeah. We're running low on time, Rick. Can we see some of Norma Shearer's?
We're going to talk about Norma Shearer because the signal back that there is pretty weak. Norma Shearer is a work in progress. She was the winner of the Oscar the year before Marie, born in Montreal. She's best known for her roles in the pre-code era. Now, the pre-code era was the era up to 1934, before the studios were, before a set of rules, a code was imposed on the studios about what they could show and not show. And Norma was sort of the queen of the pre-codes. She starred in all kinds of movies that had very contentious social issues. She won her Oscar for a movie called The Divorcee, which went to show that, you know, when a man gets divorced, he can carry on whatever way he wants. But when a woman gets divorced, she can't even go out on a date with somebody else after she's been divorced. So Norma starred in some very epic movies that had that were known to feature fantastic outfits. If you've ever seen the movie Marie Antoinette, the dress that was created for her there is just stupendous. And Norma was a bit of a fashionista herself. So whenever you see her in public, she was dressed to the nines. And Norma made movies up until, you know, the early 40s, and that was the end of her career.
Rick, I understand the Norma Shearer wing is still under construction. You're still putting it together. And what can we expect? Is it going to be similar to what we've just seen with
It's going to be the same kind of design where you have things on the wall, you'll have iPads, you'll have storage, you'll have different panels on the wall to explore. And you know, that should be open later this year.
Okay, maybe we'll come back to see that wing.
Yeah, and last thing I'll mention, and I guess the signal is not strong here either. There are other remarkable Canadian women besides these three, and we wanted to honor them as well.
Okay.
So we broke them into two categories. Those that were trailblazers and those who won Oscars for other crafts. So we honor early trailblazers like Nell Shipman, for example, Faye Ray. Interesting story about Faye Ray. Her daughter, Victoria Riskin, just wrote a book about her mother and father a couple of years ago. We contacted her and we said, Victoria, can we want to feature your mother in the museum with a little story. Can you write the story for us? Now, you just published a 300-page book, so we only want 200 words for the iPad. And she said, I'd be happy to. And she said, Rick, do you want some pictures from my photo album that you can use in the museum? And she's given us some beautiful pictures that we have on display in the iPad, including a brochure from the opening day of King Kong at the Grauman Theater, which is just priceless. And a picture of her and her mother at the Academy Award in the late 70s. So, and on the Oscar side, there's only been about 80 Oscars given to Canadians over the years, but only 9 to women of those 80. So we have all those nine Oscar winners. A couple of them have won 2 Oscars each. We have them featured here as well with a little story on each of them. And really the whole
hey, Rick, thing. Rick, who are they?
Pardon me?
Who are the 9 Oscar winners?
Okay, well, and Joe, you stay back there so we don't lose the signal, and I'll give you the names here. So we had Buffy St. Marie, who won for a song called Up Where We Belong from Officer and the Gentleman. We had Beverly Schaffer, who won for in 1978 for Best Live Action Short Film. We have Terry Nash, who won Best Documentary in 1983. We have Michelle Burke, who won 2 Oscars for makeup and hairstyling. She won an Oscar for Quest for Fire in 1983 and Dracula in 1993. We have Cynthia Scott, who won an Oscar for documentary short subject in 1984. Brigitte Berman, who won best documentary feature in 1987. Anna Paquin, who was born in Canada and became a New Zealander, won for best supporting actress in the movie The Piano when she was a young girl. Toro Kobe won two Oscars in the year 2000 and 2006 for best animated short. And our latest Oscar winner was Domi Shi in 2019 for best animated short film. So there's the lineup, and for each of them, we have a little story. And because I'm here, I'm going to quickly show you Faye Ray's pictures that she, her daughter sent us. And here's the brochure from the opening night of King Kong. And Yvonne DiCarlo, do people remember her?
Oh, yeah.
Lily Munster.
Mm-hmm.
But also Joseph's wife in the Ten Commandments, among other things. So that's a very quick tour of the other little gallery.
So, you know, your museum is quite fluid. You're always going to be adding and changing and continuing.
Well, we were the beneficiaries of a great museum designed by the University of Toronto, who has a master's degree program in museum studies. And five young women designed the Marie Dressler. And 5 years later, another five women designed Mary Pickford and the History of Hollywood Gallery. So one of the things that is very clever about what they've done is the use of technology with the iPads. We can add stories, we can change.
We might have flown too close to the sun or walked too close to the wall. Oh, we're back.
Okay. I was going to say we were beneficiaries of a design that really implements the technology in a way that we can add stories, we can change stories. We don't have to, you know, reconfigure the whole museum to add more information over time.
That is very cool.
Really impressive. And an inspiration, there's no question about that. The names may not be as familiar to today's audiences, but in terms of influence in the motion picture industry, each one of these women had a great deal to do with that.
Yeah, huge. Quick question, in the last few minutes before we wrap up, something that the audience has been talking about a lot during this program. You mentioned, Rick, how important women were in the 1930s in Hollywood and how they really were in charge of the industry in so many important ways. And then that changed in the 1940s. Sal and Rick, do you have any thoughts on what might have caused that change?
Well, I can tell you what I know about it. Mm-hmm. It was all about money. And the guys on the Wall Street woke up to the fact that this was a money-making business.
Yep.
And they basically edged the women out. And that's really what happened.
Yep.
And, you know, people like Mary had since retired from the industry, so she was still involved in United Artists. But their influence was pushed aside.
That was kind of my guess. And Patty made a really good point, too, in the chat, that World War II probably contributed with government suddenly getting involved in the financing and production of films as well, and helping to move that money out of the hands of the people who had had it before and deciding who the new big players are going to be.
Right. And there's some interesting stories about how people swooped in and kind of took control. There's a great book about Rockefeller written by Carrie Beecham, that's worth reading, about how he swooped in at the right time, made his millions, and then kind of left with his millions in his pocket.
Yeah.
All right, John, do you want to do the recap for us?
Sure thing. Let me, I'll share my screen, and I have got a few things for our audience to check out. First and foremost, please go to the website of the Canadian Women in Film Museum and plan your trip. A lot of people are saying they want to see this museum. It's on their bucket list. If you're in the Northeastern United States, you don't have any excuse. These folks are just a little bit out of Toronto. You can get there. And I hope you will. And if you do, take pictures and send them to us. We would really look forward to seeing that. So here's the website. You can see information on planning your trip, information about the museum, and Rick was telling me earlier, there are a number of significant books about these women. There's a whole big bibliography to check out, and they're going to have information all about that on the website. So if you want to learn more, this is the place to go. I will include it in our follow-up email on Wednesday, so you'll have the link. But just to remind you, cdnwomeninfilm.ca. And then, of course, we've got some of our social media. You can actually see we're streaming this right now to Facebook. So you can check us out on Facebook, follow us there and see what's coming up. Instagram, you'll get previews of upcoming trips like this and lectures. Check out Sal on Twitter. Lots of classic photos, trivia, tidbits, upcoming stuff. Sal's there posting all the time. Great stuff. Do check that out. Find Sal on YouTube. The more people who follow us on YouTube, the more power YouTube gives us to share things. So please check us out and follow there, where you can see playlists about the people and programs that we talk about, virtual road trips. This will be up there. If you want to share it with your friends, please do. And of course, salstgeorge.com. You can
find mostly most important. Thank you, Rick. And thank you, Jill, for taking the time out of your schedule. This was one of the finest museums we've seen in a long time. Really beautiful.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. This has been a blast, and the audience has been just talking about how lovely you are and your museum is the whole time.
See everybody next week. Next week, we're going to the Buffalo Bill Cody Museum. We'll see you next week for that. Have a great week, everybody. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye-bye.